April 20th, Daily Video Bible Reading from the Net Bible, Judges, chapters 10 through 12 of the Old Testament. After Abimelech's death, Tola, son of Pua, grandson of Dodo, from the tribe of Issachar, rose up to deliver Israel. He lived in Shamer, in the Ephraimite hill country. He led Israel for 23 years, then died and was buried in Shamer. Jair, the Gileadite, rose up after him. He led Israel for 22 years. He had 30 sons who rode on 30 donkeys and possessed 30 cities. To this day, these towns are called Havoth Jair. They are in the land of Gilead. Jair died and was buried in Kamon. The Israelites again did evil in the Lord's sight. They worshipped the Baals and the Ashtars, as well as the gods of Syria, Sidon, Moab, the Ammonites, and the Philistines. They abandoned the Lord and did not worship him. The Lord was furious with Israel and turned them over to the Philistines and Ammonites. They ruthlessly oppressed the Israelites that 18th year, that is, all the Israelites living east of the Jordan in Amorite country in Gilead. The Ammonites crossed the Jordan to fight with Judah, Benjamin, and Ephraim. Israel suffered greatly. The Israelites cried out for help to the Lord. We have sinned against you. We abandon our God and worship the Baals. The Lord said to the Israelites, did I not deliver you from Egypt, the Amorites, the Ammonites, the Philistines, the Sidonians, Amalek, and Midian when they oppressed you? You cried out for help to me, and I delivered you from their power. But since you abandon me and worship other gods, I will not deliver you again. Go and cry for help to the gods you have chosen. Let them deliver you from trouble. But the Israelites said to the Lord, we have sinned. You do to us as you see fit, but deliver us today. They threw away the foreign gods they owned and worshiped the Lord. Finally, the Lord grew tired of seeing Israel suffer so much. The Ammonites assembled and camped in Gilead. The Israelites gathered together and camped in Mizpah. The leaders of Gilead said to one another, who is willing to lead the charge against the Ammonites? He will become the leader of all who live in Gilead. Now Jephthah, the Gileadite, was a brave warrior. His mother was a prostitute, but Gilead was his father. Gilead's wife also gave him sons. When his wife's sons grew up, they made Jephthah leave and said to him, you are not going to inherit any of our father's wealth, because you are another woman's son. So Jephthah left his half-brothers and lived in the land of Tob. Lawless men joined Jephthah's gang and traveled with him. It was some time after this when the Ammonites fought with Israel. When the Ammonites attacked, the leaders of Gilead asked Jephthah to come back from the land of Tob. They said, come, be our commander so we can fight with the Ammonites. Jephthah said to the leaders of Gilead, but you hated me and made me leave my father's house. Why do you come to me now when you are in trouble? The leaders of Gilead said to Jephthah, that may be true, but now we pledge to you our loyalty. Come with us and fight with the Ammonites. Then you will become the leader of all who live in Gilead. Jephthah said to the leaders of Gilead, all right, if you take me back to fight with the Ammonites and the Lord gives them to me, I will be your leader. The leaders of Gilead said to Jephthah, the Lord will judge any grievances you have against us if we do not do as you say. So Jephthah went with the leaders of Gilead. The people made him their leader and commander. Jephthah repeated the terms of the agreement before the Lord in Mizpah. Jephthah sent messengers to the Ammonite king, saying, why have you come against me to attack my land? The Ammonite king said to Jephthah's messengers, because Israel stole my land when they came up from Egypt, from the Arnon River in the south to the Jabbok River in the north, and as far west as the Jordan. Now return it peaceably. Jephthah sent messengers back to the Ammonite king and said to him, this is what Jephthah says. Israel did not steal the land of Moab and the land of the Ammonites. When they left Egypt, Israel traveled through the desert as far as the Red Sea and then came to Kadesh. Israel sent messengers to the king of Edom, saying, "Please allow us to pass through your land." But the king of Edom rejected the request. Israel sent the same request to the king of Moab, but he was unwilling to cooperate. So Israel stayed at Kadesh. Then Israel went through the desert and bypassed the land of Edom and the land of Moab. They traveled east of the land of Moab and camped on the other side of the Arnon River. They did not go through Moabite territory. The Arnon was Moab's border. Israel sent messengers to King Sihon, the Amorite king who ruled in Heshbon, and said to him, "Please allow us to pass through your land to our land." But Sihon did not trust Israel to pass through his territory. He assembled his whole army, camped in Jahaz, and fought with Israel. The Lord God of Israel handed Sihon and his whole army over to Israel, and they defeated them. Israel took all the land of the Amorites who lived in that land. They took all the Amorite territory from the Arnon River on the south to the Jabbok River on the north, from the desert in the east to the Jordan in the west. Since the Lord God of Israel has driven out the Amorites before his people Israel, do you think you can just take it from them? You have the right to take what Chemosh your God gives you, but we will take the land of all whom the Lord our God has driven out before us. Are you really better than Balak, son of Zippor, king of Moab? Did he dare to quarrel with Israel? Did he dare to fight with them? Israel has been living in Heshbon and its nearby towns, in Aroer and its nearby towns, and in all the cities along the Arnon for 300 years. Why did you not reclaim them during that time? I have not done you wrong, but you were doing wrong by attacking me. May the Lord, the judge, judge this day between the Israelites and the Ammonites. But the Ammonite king disregarded the message sent by Jephthah. The Lord's spirit empowered Jephthah. He passed through Gilead and Manasseh and went to Mizpah in Gilead. From there he approached the Ammonites. Jephthah made a vow to the Lord, saying, "If you really do hand the Ammonites over to me, then whoever is the first to come through the doors of my house to meet me when I return safely from fighting the Ammonites, he will belong to the Lord, and I will offer him up as a burnt sacrifice." Jephthah approached the Ammonites to fight with them, and the Lord handed them over to him. He defeated them from Aroer all the way to Minnith, 20 cities in all, even as far as Abel Karamim. He wiped them out. The Israelites humiliated the Ammonites. When Jephthah came home to Mizpah, there was his daughter hurrying out to meet him, dancing to the rhythm of tambourines. She was his only child. Except for her, he had no son or daughter. When he saw her, he ripped his clothes and said, "Oh no, my daughter, you have completely ruined me. You have brought me disaster. I made an oath to the Lord, and I cannot break it." She said to him, "My father, since you made an oath to the Lord, do to me as you promised. After all, the Lord vindicated you before your enemies, the Ammonites." She then said to her father, "Please grant me this one wish. For 2 months, allow me to walk through the hills with my friends and mourn my virginity." He said, "You may go." He permitted her to leave for 2 months. She went with her friends and mourned her virginity as she walked through the hills. After 2 months, she returned to her father, and he did to her as he had vowed. She died a virgin. Her tragic death gave rise to a custom in Israel. Every year, Israelite women commemorate the daughter of Jephthah, the Gileadite, for 4 days. The Ephraimites assembled and crossed over to Zaphon. They said to Jephthah, "Why did you go and fight with the Ammonites without asking us to go with you? We will burn your house down right over you." Jephthah said to them, "My people and I were entangled in controversy with the Ammonites. I asked for your help, but you did not deliver me from their power. When I saw that you were not going to help, I risked my life and advanced against the Ammonites, and the Lord handed them over to me. Why have you come up to fight with me today?" Jephthah assembled all the men of Gilead, and they fought with Ephraim. The men of Gilead defeated Ephraim because the Ephraimites insulted them, saying, "You Gileadites are refugees in Ephraim, living within Ephraim's and Manasseh's territory." the Gileadites captured the fords of the Jordan River opposite Ephraim. Whenever an Ephraimite fugitive said, "Let me cross over," the men of Gilead asked him, "Are you an Ephraimite?" If he said no, then they said to him, "Say Shabaleth." If he said Sabaleth and could not pronounce the word correctly, they grabbed him and executed him right there at the fords of the Jordan. On that day, 42,000 Ephraimites fell dead. Jephthah led Israel for 6 years, then he died and was buried in his city in Gilead. After him, Ibzan of Bethlehem led Israel. He had 30 sons. He arranged for 30 of his daughters to be married outside his extended family, and he arranged for 30 young women to be brought from outside as wives for his sons. Ibzan led Israel for 7 years. Then he died and was buried in Bethlehem. After him, Elon the Zebulunite led Israel for 10 years. Then Elon the Zebulunite died and was buried in Ajalon in the land of Zebulun. After him, Abdon, son of Hillel, the Parathonite, led Israel. He had 40 sons and 30 grandsons who rode on 70 donkeys. He led Israel for 8 years. Then Abdon, son of Hillel, the Parathonite, died and was buried in Parathon, in the land of Ephraim, in the hill country of the Amalekites. God, I always find it interesting that Jephthah blames his daughter. He says, "You have completely ruined me. You have brought me disaster." But it was his actions that were going to cause her to lose her life. I'm not sure what Jephthah was thinking. I'm sure it had something to do with ego when he went against what you wanted him to do and also made an oath of a human to you in exchange for giving him what he wanted, knowing full well that Mosaic law had forbidden anything to do with what he had promised you, and an oath to the Lord at that time was supposed to be kept, but there was a part of the Mosaic law that allowed people, if that oath was going to cause them to do more sin, that they could actually get out of it, and yet he followed through with it. Crazy. But I think of Jephthah's words. "You have completely ruined me. You have brought me disaster." And I think about that a lot. How many times we have blamed others, or how many times we have blamed you for our own choices. Our own choices of sin. Our own choices of refusing to take responsibility. It just seems so much easier sometimes to make somebody else responsible for the disaster we're in. Which, ironically, takes us then longer to get out of the disaster by delaying it by refusing to take responsibility for our actions. I actually had somebody who lied, cheated, betrayed me. Oh, you can go down the whole list. And when I caught them and confronted them with this information, their first reaction, honestly, the first things out of their mouth was to blame it on me. Yeah, not so sure that's going to work. But then I think how many times I have done that with you, God, that the pain I'm in must be coming from you because you're trying to teach me a lesson. It couldn't be because you're punishing me for something that I had done wrong, heaven forbid. That the cycle I'm currently in, because it's not what I want, then it must be you doing something to me. So I'm even more guilty because I'm actually blaming you, God, for my choices. And more importantly, I'm blaming you for the consequences of my sin, where those are fully my responsibility. Not only fully my responsibility, but I am also responsible for confessing them to you. The sin, my attitude towards the consequences, and any other fallout that happens from that with relationships and situations. God, today, I just ask that everyone who's listening to this video take a moment and sit down with you and ask you to search their heart and find those things. I'm sure we want to take responsibility. It kind of reminds me of growing up when we had done something wrong. There were four kids in our family. When we had done something wrong, the easiest thing to do was go and hide, because it would delay that process of one of us actually getting in trouble. Our parents would have to come find us. It was also kind of humorous because they named us with all J names. So it was J, one of you just come here because you're in trouble. And then, of course, we'd laugh and we would be in more trouble. So that delaying and taking responsibility, I don't want to call it a common reaction, but it is a reaction that we're very used to doing, unfortunately. I just pray, God, that everyone just take time today and sit down with you and just say, search my heart, God. Search my heart for these things that I'm not taking responsibility, that I'm actually trying to attempt to hand over to somebody else. Or I'm trying to hand them over to you, God. That the responsibility of my actions, the responsibilities of my sin, the consequences of my sin are somehow your responsibility. Gosh, even saying it out loud just sounds so wrong on so many levels, but I know it's what we do. I know it's what I do. Then when you have made clear and put it on our heart, those situations we need to deal with, please allow us to come to you in full confession, taking full responsibility for what we've done, allowing that forgiveness process to occur with you in our relationship with us. God, I ask for healing relationships to come out of this, whether it's with other people who they have put that responsibility on, or if it's the relationship with you that needs to get healed in their own hearts. God, I thank you for the strength that you're going to give everyone to allow them to do this and work through this process. This isn't anything that's easy. It's something that we've gotten in a really bad habit of doing. It's everyone else's fault. It's the media's fault. It's the school's fault. It's the church's fault. It's everything but my fault. God, I don't want that. I want to take responsibility. I want to deal with it, and I want to move on so we can get to the things you do want me to do in this lifetime for you and quit delaying it like a 2-year-old throwing a tantrum. God, I just love you so much for your faithfulness. In your son's name I pray. Amen.